lot of people, mostly young boys, cut up their bodies, put them in the freezer. There was some cannibalism involved. Nasty, nasty stuff. He lived in the state of Wisconsin. His lawyers, on his behalf, entered a plea of guilty, but mentally ill, and were saying that his mental illness that they were trying to show met the definition of insanity was a sexual dysfunction that we're not talking about. We're not looking at that chapter, but pedophilia. That he was fixated on younger boys in particular, and also was only sexually aroused by dead people. And so that was the defense that was entered for him, unsuccessful. They entered guilty but mentally ill. It was one of those 3 out of 4 times it's not successful. He was just found straight up guilty and sent to prison, where he was later killed, actually, while he was in prison. Staten Island Slasher, that's what the New York Post called him. I mentioned him a little bit earlier when we were talking about schizophrenia symptoms. This was a man in New York that I worked with at Kirby Forensic Psychiatric Hospital. That's what it looks like right there. It's on Ward's Island, Keyville Island, underneath the Triborough Bridge in New York City. This is a man who was has schizophrenia, hearing voices, telling him to rid the world of evil, bought a machete, went on the Staten Island Ferry, killed 2 people, injured 7 of them. He was found not guilty by reason of insanity. He was sent to Kirby Forensic Hospital and had been there for a number of years by the time that I got there. While he was at Kirby, he was taking medication. His symptoms had remitted. He was involved in individual therapy with one of the psychologists there. He was involved in the work programs there. Had never been in a violent episode at all, never lashing out at other patients, was participating in the groups that were available. He felt horribly, horribly remorseful for what he had done and the crime that he had committed. Recognized that he had a serious mental illness that would require treatment for the rest of his life, and that he had to keep taking his medication, because he didn't want to do that ever again. You know, he knew that that was a serious thing that had happened and that it was his responsibility. He felt guilty. I need to take responsibility and take medication and make sure that I'm in treatment for this illness for the rest of my life. And so his attorneys then argued that he should be released to a less secure mental hospital. And so what happens then is, first of all, the treatment team evaluates him to see, do they think that he is not dangerous and not mentally ill? And the treatment team recommended that he is mentally ill, yes, schizophrenia, but it's been successfully treated, but that he is not dangerous, and he's shown no signs of dangerousness. And the treatment team recommended that he be released to a less secure hospital, not a Kirby Forensic Hospital that had electric fences all around the perimeter and locked wards and whatnot. But he should go to a different hospital, Manhattan Psychiatric Center. So there's a courtroom in these forensic hospitals often. There's a court there. The judge comes in. The prosecution comes in. Anybody, you know, who wants to attend comes in. They have a hearing. The judge says, no, he can't be released. I want to see, you know, a longer stretch of time where this guy is okay and that he's not showing any dangerousness. And that happened with him many, many times. He ended up staying in this forensic hospital for close to 20 years before he was released to a less secure hospital. And then he was released to a less secure hospital, and then it was another few years before he was released conditionally with outpatient treatment, even though he had never shown any violence since that one horrific day where he killed these 2 people. So this is an example of how many times people can end up staying in a forensic hospital for longer than they would be had they actually been sentenced to prison. Some people spend less time in a forensic hospital than they would have when they spent in prison. Some people spend the rest of their lives in a forensic hospital, whereas in prison they probably would have been eligible for parole. So it's not the case that people who are successful with insanity defense always are getting off. They're going to a cushier place. Now, is it the case that hospitals, even like a secure one like this, are they nicer than prisons? Yes, they are, because people aren't in individual cells. They can walk around the wards. The wards are locked. But they have more freedom of movement, at least within a ward. There are more groups. There are things that they can participate in. They can get treatment, psychiatry and psychological treatment, individual group treatment. They can work, you know, they're in the confines of the hospital. There's a lot more going on. But is there also violence that goes on in these hospitals? Yes, there is. Is there also the other kind of nasty things that you heard about happening in prison that goes on here? Yes, those things happen here too. So it's not like going to Club Med to serve out, you know, your mental illness. They're nicer than prisons, but they're not you know, the nicest facility that there is. Now, what about somebody, back to my fictitious example, Joe? He's committed a crime. He's robbed 7-Eleven, and he is hearing voices. He's extremely disorganized, and he doesn't even understand that he's done a crime. He doesn't understand that he's, you know, been arrested. He doesn't know what is happening at all. That raises the question of whether or not somebody is competent to stand trial. Competency, again, defined using legal terms, and there are really 2 broad things to consider to determine whether or not somebody is competent to stand trial. First, a person has to understand that they've been charged with a crime. They have to understand that you've been arrested, you're in the legal system, you've been charged with X, Y, or Z, what that means. And then second, they have to be able to assist an attorney in his or her defense. So there's kind of a factual piece of this, but then there's also more of a cognitive sort of piece of this. And our Constitution guarantees that when people are charged with a crime, they have the right to face their accusers. You can't be tried in absentia. And you also have the right to a speedy trial, really, due process. You can't be left hanging around in the criminal justice system indefinitely with charges hanging over your head. So if somebody is found, though, not competent to stand trial, what happens to them? Well, are the charges dropped and then they're, you know, well, we can't try them, so look, no, that's not what happens. What happens if somebody's found not competent to stand trial is that they also are sent to a forensic hospital. Here, though, the goal is not to necessarily treat their mental illness. The goal really is just to restore them to be competent to stand trial. That's it. Now, presumably, to help somebody become competent to stand trial, you have to treat their mental illness. Why else would they not be competent? But really, the goal is to at least reduce their symptoms enough so they can, A, understand the charges against themselves that they've been charged with, and B, assist an attorney in the defense. So you can treat somebody with bipolar disorder who's extremely manic, and you can bring their mania down, and then they may be, like, severely depressed. But if they understand, yes, I've been charged with robbery, I understand that, and they can help their attorney by describing what happened, what was going on, they'll be found competent to stand trial, even though they now are in a depressive episode. So it doesn't mean that the mental illness is gone. It only means that somebody is competent to stand trial. That's the only reason somebody is sent to a forensic hospital. So they usually do get treatment, because treating mental illness is typically the first step towards restoring confidence. But you don't have to be without mental illness, right? All the symptoms don't have to go away to be found competent to stand trial. Then somebody is, once they're found competent to stand trial, then they go and stand trial for those charges. Now they may then enter a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity, but yet they still have to go through this procedure. So I put up here, this doesn't have to do with legal and ethical issues and mental illness per se, but it's just a broad question of whether or not children are competent to stand trial. You know, there's been a trend that now seems to be reversing a bit, but for the past 15, 20 years, there's been a legal trend to try juveniles as adults. Kids, you know, 13, 14, 15 years old who have committed crimes of a pretty serious nature, lots of states want to get in there and show they're tough on crime, so they're going to treat these kids as adults. They're tried as adults, and then they're found guilty, they're given an adult prison sentence. They're not sent to juvenile hall. They can be sent to prison for the rest of their life. But are children competent to stand trial? I know we haven't talked about the development yet. We'll do that next week, but brains are continuing to develop throughout adolescence, even in early adulthood, particularly the frontal lobes, that help us regulate our behavior, particularly impulsive behavior and emotion regulation. A lot of crimes that kids do, as heinous as they are, often involve problems in impulse control and emotion regulation. So if this part of the brain is not fully developed in a kid, but yet we want to try them as an adult and assume that they are competent to stand trial, even if they have no mental illness. I think now there's enough neuroscience that's influencing the way the legal system works to suggest that maybe kids shouldn't be considered competent to stand trial, and maybe they shouldn't actually be tried as adults. So some examples here of people that I actually work with that were found incompetent to stand trial. So two completely different outcomes. These aren't their real names. But first, Jane, this is a woman that I worked with who was at this forensic hospital where I work, Kirby Forensic Hospital, and she was found not competent to stand trial. She was someone who has schizophrenia, pretty severe form, not treated very well with medication. She was actually a patient in another hospital in New York called Creedmoor Psychiatric Center in Queens, where she committed her crime. Her crime was setting a fire. So she set a fire to the kind of dormitory where she lived. Setting fires for her was her way she dealt with stress. When her symptoms exacerbated and she felt she was under stress, she was pressured, she lit a match and poof, set fires. Not a very effective coping strategy, but that's what she did. So she set a fire at Creedmoor as a patient with schizophrenia in the mental hospital. The hospital decided to press charges against her, charging her with arson. She had no idea that arson was a crime, what it meant, what was second degree arson. She was in no shape to assist an attorney in her defense. She was extremely disorganized, very paranoid. So she was found not competent to stand trial. So she was then transferred from Creedmoor Psychiatric Center to Kirby Forensic for a period of 3 months with the goal, and the only goal, being to restore her to competence to stand trial. Well, at the end of 3 months, she was not competent to stand trial. She was taking medication. She was receiving treatment, but the symptoms were not abating. She still was not able to help her attorney not understand arson. It took several rounds, actually, for her going to 3 months, okay, we'll extend to 3 months, 3 months, okay, let's give her 6 months, a year. It took a couple of years for the treatment to actually work enough for her so that she could then understand that she had been charged with arson and understand what a prosecuting attorney is, what's a defense attorney, what's a judge, what's the legal system, what's going to happen here, and so that she could meaningfully collaborate with her own attorney and talk about what it is that she wanted to do, what kind of plea, what happened, what was going on. It took a couple of years for this to happen. So she was finally restored to competence. She was found competent to stand trial. So then what happened was she had to go from Kirby Forensic Hospital to Rikers Island, the jail in New York City, to await trial. So her case was put on the docket, but she had to wait in Rikers Island until she could go and face these charges. Well, in Rikers Island, it's a very chaotic place. It's a jail. It's overcrowded. She didn't always necessarily get her medication and certainly didn't get it on time. It's an extremely stressful environment for her. And so what did she do? She set a fire in Rikers Island. Her symptoms exacerbated. She became very ill again. And now she's back again, incompetent to stand trial, back at Kirby Forensic. And we're starting all over. By the time I started to work with her, she was actually doing pretty well. But she'd been through the cycle a couple of times where she's competent. She goes to Rikers Island, relapses, starts all over again. What a ridiculous cycle for her to go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. The question came up as to whether or not she would ever really be competent to stand trial. And so when I was working with her, we were beginning to, with her legal team, initiate what were called Jackson proceedings. And that's based on this case, Jackson versus the state of Indiana, and the book goes into this, but this was a man who had severe, in legal terms, a mental defect, intellectual disability, who had committed a crime, he stole a coat, he's cold, he stole a coat. But this man was never gonna be competent to stand trial, never, because his intellectual disability was so severe, he was never gonna understand the legal system, he was never really gonna be able to assist an attorney in his defense. And so for Mr. Jackson, who was never gonna be competent to stand trial, what was gonna happen here? So what this court ruling rendered in this particular case of Jackson was that a person can be held with these charges and can be considered incompetent to stand trial only as long as it takes to determine if, in fact, he will ever or she will ever be competent to stand trial. And if the determination is the person will not become competent to stand trial, then what has to happen is a new set of legal proceedings begin where a person is committed to a forensic hospital but under civil law and not criminal law. So they're not just set free, okay, you're never going to be competent to stand trial, we're going to just drop those charges because we can't face them and have a nice day. No, they're then committed still to a hospital but under civil law. So in the case of Jane, that was the question that the treatment team was believing. She was never going to become competent. And there were too many bureaucratic hurdles in the way of allowing her to, when she was competent, there was a courtroom in Kirby. Why couldn't we just do it right there? Why did she keep going to Rikers Island? Well, there was no way around that. The legal system is what it is, and there was no way of circumventing that, just in the hope that it would keep her from relapsing, having to wait it out in Rikers Island. She had to go back. And so if they could have held the proceedings in Kirby, she could have faced those charges, where she would enter a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity. It would have been successful, and then this whole thing could have been dropped. But instead, for years of this woman's life, she was spent working with psychologists like myself, helping her to learn what's a prosecuting attorney, what's a defense attorney, rather than moving on to more meaningful aspects of treating this woman's schizophrenia. So the Jackson proceedings, we're going to say she's never going to be competent to stand trial. Let's just commit her, but under civil law, she would still be staying in Kirby Forensic Hospital until she was no longer dangerous. Then she might be transferred to a different hospital. But she was going to be somebody who's going to be considered dangerous for a while, and somebody whose mental illness was still going to be lingering. The symptoms never went away with her. She had severe symptoms that medications really weren't making much of an impact. But at least we could have dropped this back and forth, teaching her about what a defense attorney is, meeting with your own attorney, and going through all of that. Now this other guy, Ted, completely different outcome here. This is a guy who committed a petty crime, and at the time he was arrested, he was kind of screaming and making a lot of noises and nonsense and a bunch of stuff coming out of his mouth, and he was brought before a judge, and he pulls down his pants and makes a bunch of nonsense noises, and the judge says, what are you kidding me? This guy's not competent to stand trial. Get him out of here. Sent him to Kirby Forensic for 3 months, where immediately upon arrival, all of a sudden, those symptoms went away. He wasn't pulling down his pants. He wasn't saying things that didn't make any sense. He seemed to be doing just fine. So at the end of 3 months, the team says, he's going to go. He's competent. So he goes back to the judge, and now in front of the judge, not making sense, pulls his pants down. The judge is, are you kidding me, people? He's not competent. What kind of professionalism is this? Get him out of here. He comes back to Kirby. And now again, on arrival back, he's doing miraculously better. And he did this a couple of times, and the third time he goes before the judge, and this time he doesn't, pull down his pants. He's, very well-mannered, and he says, he pleads actually guilty to his crime. And then the judge says, oh, I see that you've served 9 months here at Kirby Forensic, so that's time served. You're free to go. So that's an example of somebody manipulating the system. the only example that I had ever heard of and that saw, and that the people at the Princeton Hospital where I worked had ever seen. It doesn't happen, you know, very often. People are wise, you know, what's happening here pretty quickly. But that's an example of somebody who did manipulate the system and was biding his time. He wasn't going to get a long sentence anyway, maybe a year, two at most, in the forensic hospital by doing this game back and forth, by acting like he had a mental illness in front of the judge, but then not acting that way when he was back at the hospital. So those things don't happen, but they do happen. They did happen, so that's why I'm sharing his TED example with you. All right, I'm going to stop here, but next week we'll talk about commitment under civil law and what that means, what the difference between civil commitment is and criminal commitment.